I've been sent a very interesting little toy to play with. This is the ZimaBoard 832, which, according to their website, is a hackable single board server. There's a lot to like about this gadget, so let's take a look. What is this then? It's a small single board computer, a bit like a Raspberry Pi. So why would you choose this over a Raspberry Pi then? First and foremost, this little server has an Intel processor instead of the ARM processor used by the Raspberry Pi. That means you can run regular Microsoft Windows on it if you wanted to, and it'll run all of the regular 32 and 64-bit flavors of Linux too. It's also got 2 gigabit Ethernet ports on it, which is very handy if you want to use it as a firewall or a router. The Intel processor and 8 gig of RAM means that this device makes for a powerful firewall. It could easily run OpenWRT with VPN tunnels out to remote locations, run a VPN server, and even some packet inspection too. Okay, so it wouldn't be as fast as a device with dedicated hardware for that purpose, but we're talking about a little multi-purpose box that costs £160 and runs at 6 watts. Not a large power-hungry PC or dedicated hardware. It's also got a regular PCI Express slot along the side, so as you can plug in PCI Express cards like graphics cards if you want specialist processing power, or SATA interface cards if you needed more drives. Except you probably wouldn't need to add a SATA card because this ZimaBoard has 2 built-in SATA ports already. That middle port, by the way, is the power for your SATA drives, and there's an adapter supplied in the box. This means that you can use it as a NAS, or more usefully, a media server, running something like Jellyfin or Plex. The processor supports hardware transcoding of video at 1080p, and even some 4K formats too. There's 32 gig of onboard eMMC storage, which can get eaten up quite quickly by the operating system, so you'll want to plug in an external drive if you're going to use it for those purposes. Now I'm going to start my review by going through all of the issues I've had with the ZimaBoard, because there are quite a few, but the reason I want to start with the bad points is because overall this is truly quite a great bit of kit, and I want to finish on a good note, so let's get the bad stuff out of the way first. The processor in this thing is an Intel Celeron J3455. It's a quad-core CPU with a base frequency of 1.5 GHz, bursting to 2.3 GHz. Sounds good, but this is a CPU from 2016, so 7 years old at the time of putting this video together. It's actually the exact same processor that's in my Synology NAS, the DS918 Plus. Synology's latest version of that NAS, the DS923 Plus, actually uses an AMD Ryzen 1600 CPU, which is 141% faster than the old Intel, despite being only slightly newer at 6 years old. This board isn't going to win any prizes for performance, but that might not be an issue for you depending on how you use this gadget, and it did surprise me when it came to Plex, but I'll talk about that later. There's no Wi-Fi. This is Ethernet only, so you'll need to hardwire it to your home network. You can always plug a USB Wi-Fi adapter in, provided you can get the drivers installed for your chosen operating system, but that's not as sleek as having it built in. CasaOS, the custom operating system designed by Icewhale, the company behind the ZimaBoard, has been made to be as simple as possible to use. That is both its strength and its weakness. I'll give you a good tour of CasaOS later in the video, but for now I'll just say that you are limited in what you can do on it to basically running Docker containers. They have put together some one-click installs for a limited set of commonly used containers. But if you want to install virtual machines like Home Assistant OS to get its full functionality, then you're out of luck if you just want to use their web interface. Underneath, it's just running Debian Linux, so you can technically install whatever you like if you SSH to it. But that leaves the realms of simplicity for beginners, and also leads me on to problem number 4. The default CasaOS credentials. Be very careful here. When you set this device up, you are asked to configure it all via the web interface. It talks you through creating a username and password, which is all great, but hidden beneath the surface is the operating system's default username and password. If you use SSH to connect to the ZimaBoard, then out of the box, the username and password are both set to CasaOS. There is no way to change this in the web interface. And if you don't know how to change a password using the Linux command line, then this is quite a security issue. And if you don't know how to do that, then here's a quick demo. Okay, I'm doing this on a Mac using Terminal, but you can do this on a Windows PC using PuTTY if you want. You need to start by SSHing to your CasaOS installation. And on a Mac, you do this by typing SSH CasaOS at casaos.local. And then the password is CasaOS, enter. Okay, now we need to run the passwd command, and we type in the old password, which is CasaOS, and then the new password twice, and done. Right then, with those bad points out of the way and all in the past, let's discuss why this little server is actually amazing. So, as I said before about CasaOS, it's designed to be really easy to use for beginners. Using Docker containers can be really complicated to get your head around, but what Icewell have done here is handpick a selection of commonly used containers, things like Plex, Home Assistant, Pi-hole, and turn them all into one-click installs. I feel like I'm underselling just how easy this makes things, so I'm going to show you in real time an installation of Home Assistant on CasaOS. So this is CasaOS, and you can see I've already got Plex installed here because I'm having to play around with that, but I still want to talk to you about that later. For now, I'm going to show you the App Store. And if you have a quick look through the App Store, you can see there's quite a lot of commonly used Docker containers here. You've got AdGuard, Cloudflare D, Deluge, the BitTorrent client, Grafana for graph stuff, Handbrake for video encoding. And if you really wanted to go off-piste, you could go to a custom install and put in your Docker container name manually that you want to get installed. For now though, I'm going to go back to the App Store and we're going to go down and find Home Assistant. Now, I'm going to click on that and then click on install, and I would show you this in total real time, but when I click on install, it'll zoom quite quickly up to 80% and then sit there for about a minute or so while it does the rest of it. So what I'll do is I'll cut back when it gets to 100%. Okay, there we go, it's got to 100%. That was probably about a minute of waiting. And then it goes back to the dashboard there. Now, it does take a good 30 seconds from this point for Home Assistant to be booted, I guess, because it's got a startup, and then we can go through the configuration process. So what I'm gonna do is I'll pause the video for a second and come back to you once this is running. Okay, I've given that a minute to boot up, so all I do now is click on the Home Assistant icon, and it'll open up with the onboarding page. I go create my smart home. I'm going to give it a name. Let's just call it that, and password. Password. Create account and choose my home location. Yeah, that'll do. I'm in United Kingdom. Next. And then it'll just do the normal setup process. So the important thing here is that to get Home Assistant up and running, I haven't had to click on anything other than install. I didn't have to make any custom settings in the actual Home Assistant Docker container. It was all pre-configured for me. So you can see here, I've now got Home Assistant up and running, and it was literally one click in CasaOS. I had to do the standard setup process for Home Assistant as well, but that didn't take long. I've just shown you that in real time. How easy is that? It's the same story for Plex too, which I've installed. Now, with Plex, you can plug a hard drive or two directly into the ZimaBoard and store your media on there. But I haven't done that. I've actually mounted an SMB share on the NAS from the ZimaBoard using the Files app on CasaOS. I did this purely as a quick test, so when you use Plex on the ZimaBoard, it streams to you, but at the same time is streaming from the NAS. I really thought this would be quite slow and problematic, but it turns out Plex works so much better on the ZimaBoard in Docker than it does on the Synology NAS. The NAS has the same processor, it's running Plex natively and not containerized, and it's got the video data locally on its own disks. There's no way it should be faster, but it is. I can't give you any scientific quantifiable data here, sorry, but the web interface just feels more responsive, videos load more quickly. I share my Plex server with a few relatives, and my brother uses a Samsung TV to access it. They've been getting a lot of buffering problems, streaming video, and we've been putting it down to his Wi-Fi, but when they tested streaming the files from Plex on the ZimaBoard, it all worked fine. Switching back to the NAS caused the problems to come back. This makes no sense to me, but at the moment it's looking like I might actually be making the ZimaBoard my permanent new Plex server, or maybe I'll start investigating Jellyfin on it. So I need to summarize this really. If you are looking at getting into the world of home servers, then you have a choice. You could go for a NAS like a Synology, where you slot your drives in and use a selection of built-in apps provided, and maybe experiment with manually installing and configuring Docker containers if you're feeling a bit adventurous. But that will cost you around £500 plus your disks. Or you could get a ZimaBoard for about £170, or less if you go for one of the lower specification models. You can then plug disks in if you want, either USB ones or SATA ones. CasaOS will give you a great starting point for playing around with Docker containers and has the manual install option for when you've got to grips with it. And then when you are really familiar with Linux, you can just install your own favorite Linux distribution on it, or even Windows if you want to. It has a DisplayPort output so you can connect it to a monitor if you wanted to use it as a compact PC or a media player. Anyway, I hope you found this review useful. Please give the video a like if you did, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel to see more from me. I'll put links down in the description in case you're interested in buying one of these or want more information. If you do buy one, then please use my affiliate links because that really helps to keep this channel going. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.